Good evening, and welcome to the St. Paul City Council Ward Number 2 Candidate Forum. I'm Kitty Goggins, and I'm a league-trained moderator and member. Today's forum is sponsored by the League of Women Voters of St. Paul and Cherokee Park United Church. On behalf of the sponsoring groups, I would like to welcome you all here tonight, the candidates, those of us who joined us in the live audience, as well as those viewing the forum on cable TV or online. The forum will last approximately 2 hours. We believe the success of St. Paul depends on the values, knowledge, and commitment of our elected officials. Thus, it is essential for the public to better understand the views, opinions, and commitments of people running for elected office in St. Paul. It is this understanding that better equips voters with information to make informed voting decisions. We appreciate the candidates and the audience members taking the time to be here tonight. This year, the citizens of St. Paul are electing a city council member for Ward 2. All eligible candidates listed in the Minnesota Secretary of State website as registered candidates were invited to participate, and 4 are appearing here tonight. Each participating candidate has agreed to the forum rules. Each candidate will give a 2-minute introductory statement. The candidates will then have 1 minute to answer each question and 30 seconds for rebuttal if necessary. Candidates' order for the opening statement and the questions was set using a random or number generator. At the end of the question period, each candidate will have 2 minutes for closing statements in reverse order of the opening statements. We'll use questions written by the audience today, as well as questions that were submitted in advance to the St. Paul League's email. Questions can be written on the index card provided by the League volunteers and can be submitted to the League volunteers throughout the forum. All questions must be addressed to all candidates, and no personal or attacking questions will be allowed. All questions become the property of the League of Women Voters. Answers to the questions similarly need to focus on the questions themselves. A candidate's record may be discussed, but personal attacks will not be tolerated. A timer will signal candidates when they have 30 seconds remaining by putting up a yellow card, if you could illustrate, thank you, written on it. And when the timer puts up a red stop card, candidates need to conclude. Candidates, you can finish your sentence, but I will enforce this rule to make sure we give the same amount of time to each of the candidates. We ask that the audience hold all applause until the end of the forum this evening. Let me now introduce the candidates for St. Paul City Council Ward 2 that are participating in this evening's forum in alphabetical order. Bill Huskell, Lindsay Ferris-Martin, Helen Myers, and Rebecca Nager. We will now begin with the opening statements. Remember, candidates, you have 2 minutes for each response. We will be starting with Lindsay Ferris-Martin.
Thank you. Thank you guys so much for having me, and thank you for the League of Women Voters for having us, and more importantly, thank you to the neighbors who are here today in full force. I love seeing you all here. I'm a little bit nervous, though. I'm happy to share my opinions tonight and insights this evening, but I cannot stress enough in these forums that my voice is only a fraction of the conversation when dealing with policies and city ordinances and implementations of what's coming forward after November 5th. The voices of my neighbors and the businesses in my community will carry me forward through my decision-making process. I'm a social media consultant, and I work with small businesses, and I'm a huge small business advocate. I left the ad agency world 7 years ago to work on my own to help small businesses integrate organically with their communities, to leverage support and affinity, and to build a cohesive network between neighborhoods and community, leveraging free tools such as social media. I have always had an innate passion to make a difference, and I have a sincere care for the well-being of my neighbors, and that's what's propelled me to run in the first place. Besides this, I've never had a political aspiration in my life. I am humbled to be endorsed by the Veterans Party of Minnesota. It is a nonpartisan organization that, like those who serve and pledge an oath to protect our Constitution, I too will work hard to uphold the integrity of our state's Constitution and our city's charter. I'm running for city council to lift up my neighbor's voice with action and do meaningful work. I hope to earn your votes so you can experience the difference in city council services.
Thank you. Next, we have Rebecca Naker.
Well, thank you so much to the League of Women Voters, to Cherokee Park United Church, and to all of you for being here tonight. I really believe in local government, and I am so glad that you showing up here tonight means that you do too. I think sometimes when you look at the national level, at the state level in politics, the local government level is really the only one that still works, where you can still get things done. And so I really appreciate the League and Cherokee Park United Church and all of you for being here and getting engaged in this process. My name is Rebecca Naker, and I am a proud resident of the West Side. I'm a former middle school science teacher. I'm the wife of a high school English teacher, and I'm the mom of two young boys. And I've been proud to represent Ward 2 on the St. Paul City Council for the last 4 years. I am running for this office because I believe so strongly in the power of government to do good in St. Paul and in all of us. And I don't say that I believe in us and that I believe in St. Paul with no basis. I believe in us because I have seen what we have been able to do together over the last 4 years to make our community greater. I have seen us pass one of the strongest earned sick and safe time ordinances in the entire country, raise our minimum wage to $15 an hour so no one working full-time lives in poverty. I've seen us create our first ever $10 million affordable housing trust fund, expand free recreational center program hours so kids can partake in more activities free of charge. I've seen us make our streets safer, including Cesar Chavez right out here, by lowering speed limits, adding bike lanes, and making it easier for pedestrians to cross. I am excited about all that we have to do together ahead. We are not done. We have so much more to do, and that is why I'm running again. And I have made it a priority to be responsible and responsive to my constituents, and I will continue to do that if I'm reelected in the next 4 years. Thank you for being here tonight.
Thank you. Next we have Helen Myers.
Hello, my name is Helen Myers. I'm the candidate, of the Socialist Workers Party. I think that the biggest task facing working people is to organize and act independent of the ruling capitalists and their political parties, the Democrats and Republicans. What we need in St. Paul, in Minnesota, in the whole country, is to build a movement with a fighting program to confront the economic, social, and moral crisis that's caused today by the capitalist economic system. Workers are being ground down by the skyrocketing cost of housing, the opioid epidemic, the lack of access to health care, a criminal justice system that discriminates with its frame-ups, plea bargains, outrageous prison sentences, all of which disproportionately hit workers who are Black. And every action that advances the organization of the working class and the confidence that workers have in our own collective power to step onto the road to overthrowing the ruling capitalists and bring workers and farmers to power. It's why I encourage all workers, unionized and organized, to back fights that are happening. Right now, to back the fight of the 50,000 auto workers now on strike against General Motors. Join them, as I have, on their picket line in Hudson, Wisconsin, right across the river. It's only through struggle can the working class discover our fighting capacities and our worth. We can and we must put an end to the exploitation, the violence, the racial discrimination, and the dog-eat-dog values of capitalists. And I invite you to join my campaign and to join the Socialist Workers Party.
Thank you. And we have Bill Hoskell.
Good evening. I'm happy to be here this evening. I would like to ask you something. In recent years, has your quality of life here on the West Side or elsewhere within Ward 2 improved markedly under your current city council? Or do you think it's time for a change, a big change at City Hall? If so, I'm your best bet for true change in City Hall. While there is much good that is occurring throughout this ward, at the same time there remains significant neglect, some of which I have shown in the handout I gave many of you this evening. If you've not received it, it's on the table around the corner on your way out. And there are many issues that are not being addressed well at all, including out-of-control spending priorities, resulting in out-of-control property fee and assessment taxation. This is harming many, many people. Not only homeowners, but countless renters as well. Crime is increasing, and too much of it goes unreported. And too often, community outreach efforts by City Hall are disingenuous. Our trash ordinance debacle, planning for light rail streetcars on West 7th Street, and planning for Pedro Park in downtown are just three examples. Additionally, I've lost count of how many good people have told me, as I've lit dropped every corner of this ward once, and I'm now repeating it again, all the way from Summit Avenue and Ide Mill Road to Concord and Annapolis, that their emails and phone calls to our incumbent's office have not been returned. And let's not talk about canceling your 4th of July fireworks 2 years in a row now. Good grief. Again, I'm very happy to be here on the west side, which some of you say is the best side, and be before you this evening. I will do my best to answer your questions. Thank you.
Thank you for your opening statements. We are now ready for questions. Remember, candidates, you have 1 minute to respond to each question. The first question will begin with Lindsay Ferris Martin. The question is, what is one specific policy priority that you have that sets you apart from the other candidates? One specific policy priority that sets you apart from other candidates.
One specific policy priority that I have that I feel that really separates me from the other candidates is my passion to reduce redundancies in our budgeting and making our budget more transparent. Some of the other candidates will say the same thing, but I've really dug deep into our budget and our 2020 proposal and what it means for our public safety initiatives and also what it means for our TIF funding and how much of our budget we're allocating to development of major projects and how that's impacting our public safety, our education, and basic infrastructures and quality of life.
Thank you, Rebecca Knacker. Knacker, I'm sorry.
One of my policy priorities is to ensure that all families in St. Paul have access to high quality, affordable early childhood education. As I mentioned, I'm a former teacher and I'm a mom of two young boys. And I know how much the city and our schooling and our families are interrelated. There are a lot of cities around the country that have decided that they are no longer going to wait for the state or the federal government to fully fund early childhood education. And I think St. Paul needs to be the next city to decide that. It is a moral issue, it is an economic issue, it is a social justice issue. We have so many children who are not able to get into high quality care because they lack the funding or because the care is just not available. Many parts of St. Paul are actually a child care desert. So I've been working with St. Paul Public Schools, Ramsey County, and my colleagues at the city to find a way for St. Paul to create a network of affordable quality child care, and I think that'll be a game changer in terms of our quality of life and in terms of attracting new employees, new residents, and new businesses to Ward 2 and the city as a whole.
Thank you. Bill Hosko.
There's a number of unique positions that I have, but I'll talk about one, a crime map. Right now, if you go to the city's website, up at the top, there's a number of buttons you can click on. One is for maps. It's maps of recreation areas in St. Paul, biking areas, where parks are, et cetera. What also needs to be there is a link to a citywide crime map. Begins every year in January, ends that December. Every time a crime report is filed in this city, automatically a dot will go onto that map, a color-coded dot based upon the crime and where it occurred. If you zoom in on that area, if there's multiple dots, they'll spread around. You click on that dot, and it'll take you directly to the crime report. Too often, I've heard this from police officers as well, the lower-level crimes, they're encouraged to not report them and to not file police reports. That needs to end. And you do deserve to know specifically what type of crime is occurring in your neighborhood and in your city.
Thank you. Helen Myers.
Yes, my biggest priority, the priority of my campaign, is to organize with other workers to act independently of the Democrats and Republicans in this city, country, and state. We need to build, the priority would be to build a movement of millions with a fighting program that confront the economic, social, and moral crisis caused by capitalism. That would be the central campaign that I would work towards.
Thank you. The next question we have, and Helen Myers will go first on this one. Please share your perspective on the current trash collection system in St. Paul. Please share your perspective on the current trash collection system in St. Paul.
Go. Okay. Well, my opinion is that faced with the pressing need, as I said just before, to organize workers to confront the consequences of the economic and social and moral crisis produced by capitalism, deciding which capitalist gets access to trash collections or the trash collection franchise in this city is hardly a question of paramount importance to working people. Discussing this keeps us from looking at the real issues we face. How do you organize to defend workers whose wages and work and safety conditions are under attack? How do you fight for amnesty for undocumented workers? How do we bring an end to the endless wars in the Middle East and other parts and have the U.S. troops come home? But we can do this through our power, through collective solidarity and action. Then we'll be on our way to ending the system of dog-eat-dog values and look to what's needed in government that's run by workers and farmers.
Thank you. Lindsay Ferris Martin.
Oh, my trash perspective. And it's interesting. And it's interesting because Ward 2 has a lot of different perspectives on trash. Some of us are not affected by it at all. Our bills haven't increased, and we feel that maybe there are less haulers on the street. But a lot of us don't fall into that category. And we're only as good as our weakest part of our ward. So that means for our neighbors who are struggling with trash and increased bills and who haven't seen the reduction in haulers, and are not incentivized to reduce waste or to share bins, we have to speak up for them. Their rights have been taken away. Your rights have been taken away in violation of the city's charter. If we want change, we have to see it now. And that means we have to vote no. Otherwise, when we vote yes, that means we have to wait another 4 years for any changes to be made to the trash system that we had hoped to see in the first place.
Thank you. Rebecca Nager.
Thank you. I support organized trash collection. Prior to last October, St. Paul was one of the largest cities in the country that did not have an organized system. Organized collection reduces illegal dumping, which we were spending about $200,000 a year on just on public land alone until last year. It reduces wear and tear on our city streets, and you've seen our city streets. And it makes sure that people across the city are getting a fair and consistent deal with no hidden fees across the city. That said, I recognize, and I've spoken to many of you in this room about the fact that the contract is not perfect and that there are a lot of ways in which it can be better. One of the top concerns of mine is that multi-unit buildings are not able to consolidate their trash into fewer carts. I have sat down with the haulers. I have started negotiations with them on these issues, but those negotiations were put on hold once the city was subject to litigation, which we're still in. If people vote yes and if organized collection continues, which I hope it will, I and my colleagues plan to continue those negotiations with the haulers, and I have hope that those will lead to success.
Thank you. Bill Hosko.
This should have been a public referendum to begin with. And when thousands of signatures were collected requesting a public referendum, and then the city council subsequently said no, they broke the law. So then the citizens went to district court. Judge ruled in your favor. The city council stayed quiet. The mayor challenged you. He shouldn't have. State Supreme Court ruled with you again. The city council stayed quiet. And then the mayor threatens you with a massive tax increase if you don't get in line. Your representative stayed quiet again. You've witnessed a dictatorship in some respects, and you don't deserve that. And I think the politicians who've created this mess at this point should really cease and desist and allow you to vote your conscience no or possibly yes. on November 5th. Thank you.
Thank you. The next question Rebecca Naker will have first. How do you plan to balance the different needs of the diverse and economically different neighborhoods of downtown, West 7th, and West Side? How do you plan to balance the different needs of the diverse and economically different neighborhoods of downtown, West 7th, and West Side?
Thank you. This is a great question. Representing Ward 2 is a challenge in that it's a microcosm of the entire city, and I think it's probably one of the most diverse wards in the entire city. I will say I don't consider that a problem. I think it's an opportunity, and the way to deal with it is to make sure that you're as accessible and as open-minded and listening as hard as possible to your constituents. That's why I have instituted regular community coffees and happy hours and even virtual chats on Facebook for those who can't get away from the office or don't actually want to sit down and talk to other people in person, because that can be difficult. And that's a way to hear directly from people what they need. And actually, the more you listen to people, the more you realize that people really have very similar needs and perspectives across our communities: economic development, housing security, higher minimum wage, workforce stability. Those are issues that I'm hearing from families no matter where they live.
Thank you. Lindsay Ferris Martin.
I have to say that the diversity in Ward 2 is one of my favorite things that I love most about Ward 2. I work with a lot of small businesses in Ward 2, and I've heard them struggle, and I hear my neighbors struggle. But then you go down to different parts of the ward, Summit Hill, and their struggles are a little bit different. When it comes to being to finding a solution, we have to take in part all of our neighbors, and that includes our encampments and our homeless neighbors who are struggling as well, and what that means for them. We also have to include our small businesses in the conversations and how they employ their employees. And if minimum wage works across all boards, we have a lot of restaurants in downtown St. Paul, and a tip credit amendment to the minimum wage ordinance would have propelled a lot of our neighbors forward. Now it's holding them back.
Thank you. And next we have Bill Hosko.
Okay. You know, the Ward 2 is the heart of this city. I don't want to say it's necessarily the soul, but it's definitely the heart of this city. And it is very unique, and I love every corner of it. Okay, getting to the west side, based upon what I talk to people, crime is high on a lot of people's minds. It goes back to that crime map, I think, would be a benefit to a lot of people over here. There needs to be increased police patrols in those high crime areas, which this map would help dictate where they should go. There's a lot of neglected rental properties that needs to be addressed. It's been going on for too long. West 7th Street area, it'd be streetcars, light rail streetcars. That planning process needs to be investigated. It was not ethical. And then downtown, the light rail station stops are disasters. I mean, the crimes associated with them. All of the station stops need to be retrofitted to be pay-as-you-go. The honor system needs to end. Skyway security system needs to be in place with cameras, with audio, so when people are in distress, they can push a call box and somebody will talk to them immediately. And Pedro Park, the planning process for that, again, it was off the charts and needs to be restarted. Thank you.
And Helen Myers?
I think we should have to choose. I think there's enough resources, capability, talent in order to solve the problems that face all the working people in St. Paul. Excuse me. We need to organize ourselves as workers. We need to change. We need to organize and fight for power and change the way in which decisions are made in the interest of the wealthy and not in the interest of the working class. We need to fight for a federally funded public works program to put millions to work around, not just here, but everywhere. Put workers to work at union scale to build bridges and hospitals and childcare centers and mass transportation and quality housing. This is the way we can take the wealth that's produced by the workers and use it in the interests of everyone.
Thank you. The next question will be answered by Lindsay Ferris Martin first. How would you, if elected, direct the West Public Publishing site to be redeveloped in a positive way for people and not just luxury or market rate housing? How would you direct the West Publishing site to be redeveloped in a positive way for people and not just luxury or market rate housing.
It's a really good question. A lot of our major developments are at the forefront of my mind right now on how they're being funded and what types of tax breaks they're getting. So first and foremost, I want to make sure that we're not using public general funds to develop projects that could otherwise be done outside of our dollars when we have other infrastructure needs that are being sacrificed right now. Again, public safety, education, and road infrastructures. If we can have development projects come in that truly benefit all of our neighbors, including the ones on the other side of the bridge who are in tents right now, that would be fantastic if we can get some corporate cooperation and synergy and support with our neighbors on all levels.
Thank you. Helen Myers?
Problem is, so long as land is privately owned and housing development and other development is determined by the market, decent housing is going to remain unaffordable for millions of working class people. That's why I call for the nationalization of the land in order to put the soil at the service of farmers who till it, and in this case, of an urban setting, rather than the financial interests controlling it, that we open urban lands for the possibility for those who live on them to decide how they should be administered and not the financial interests of the banks and the big developers.
Thank you. Bill Hosko.
The West Publishing site, going back a little bit, it's a shame that those perfectly good buildings were destroyed and it cost you $17 million and it's been off the tax rolls for years. Don't know if the county should have ever acquired it 20 years ago when it did. The proposal that's been brought forward, I think it's a group from Los Angeles, $788 million, four towers. But they want to build it in phases. So phase one is a condo tower, 20 stories or so, an apartment tower, maybe 20, 30 stories, $250 million. The catch is they want us to pay a third of the cost. Okay, we were already invested $17 million. If we give them the land, isn't that generous enough? And whatever the design they put forward, I don't know if any of you saw it, go to billhosko.com and go back in time and you can see the design. It's really atrocious. It's right on the river. And it's the last thing the West Side needs to see from Prospect and Cherokee Park is what they're proposing. Of course, some of the housing within the apartment building should be designated affordable since there's already so much tax money put into the site. Thank you.
Rebecca Naker.
First of all, when I talk about believing in St. Paul, I think this is an excellent example of where we need to believe in our ability to achieve greatness on this site. This is an incredible development opportunity. It is an awesome opportunity to bring in the kind of commercial development that we need to balance out our tax base so that we are not paying as much in property taxes because we have more commercial development supporting our property tax needs. I also absolutely agree that the development has to benefit the people who live in St. Paul now, and we need to insist on affordable housing at that site. And I agree with Lindsay. I think that subsidizing affordable housing should be an absolute last resort. That's why my colleagues and I are interested in exploring an inclusionary zoning ordinance, which would require that any new development in St. Paul have some percentage of it be affordable without requiring public subsidy to go into the deal.
Thank you. That moves us to the next question. The first person to answer this question will be Helen Myers. What would you do to bring programming to seniors in the area? What would you do to bring programming to seniors in the area?
Well, seniors are in many areas are under attack. I just wanted to mention one thing tonight because it affects this area. There are hundreds in this area, in the city of St. Paul, and thousands in the state of Teamster seniors who are about to lose their pension because their company's been bankrupt and they were turned over to the federal government promised to pay them and now they didn't. They're reneging on it. So there are many people in need in this area. But the solution for seniors, the road forward for senior development is the same for all people. We organize ourselves, we establish health care for all, not Medicare for all, health care for all. We have a guaranteed retirement for individuals in this city, and we bring and it involves after we change and include educational opportunities for people from I believe in education from cradle to grave.
Thank you. Rebecca Naker.
First of all, we need to make sure that we fully fund our recreation centers. That's one of the places where so many seniors are coming for community, for commonality, and for structured programming. And I've been a strong supporter of continuing to increase funding for our parks and recreation programming. But I also think a lot of people in our community, as they get older, don't necessarily need to go to a formal activity, but they want to be engaged in the life of our city. They want to be able to contribute. They want to be able to volunteer their time. And that's why I'm such a strong supporter of the Mayor's Serve St. Paul idea, which is essentially a way of getting everybody in our community to be able to give back, whether that's through Friends of Mears Park, taking care of our flower beds, our gardens downtown, whether that's through helping with our pedestrian safety initiatives and helping people in our Stop For Me campaigns, whether it's tutoring kids in our rec centers and our libraries. There's so many ways to get people involved. And frankly, as we're starting to see more and more people as they get older wanting to move to St. Paul, as you door knock downtown, you see literally hundreds of couples who have decided to downsize from the suburbs and they want to be in St. Paul. There's a huge opportunity.
Thank you. Lindsay Ferris-Martin.
I like this question a lot. I've been an advocate for the Alzheimer's Association for a really long time because it's plagued my family four times over, of which I've lost four of my grandparents too. I've seen a lot, I've seen it from different perspectives for care and programming and what's needed, whether someone's at a low end of dementia or perfectly fine and functioning, early onset as well. What's important are activities. For my mom, who is an AARP member, she's active. Her activity scale is different. We also need to look at affordable housing for our seniors because it's based off of wage and how much is the medium income for our neighbors. But that's about to change with our minimum wage increase, excuse me. So we have to be sensitive to the fact that their housing is dependent on a scale where their income isn't moving, but the rest of our neighbors are. So we need to make sure that our programming and our activities are relevant to their needs as things continue to change.
Thank you. And Bill Hosko?
Two areas, downtown real quick. Remember Town Square Park? It was kind of a shame that the city, I think it was under Norm Coleman, sold it. It should have remained a park. That's an opportunity that's been sitting empty for years to turn it back into a city park, and I've long felt part of the component of it should be a senior gathering place because there is no senior place in downtown St. Paul. There's a lot of parking in the area. Evenings and weekends it could be discounted for seniors who would utilize it. In this neck of the woods, up on Stryker, near Dodd, that's where I lived when I was a child, there's some senior housing proposed up there. I've heard no good comments about its design, which is unfortunate. If I'm elected, it will have good design, and maybe that could be where there could be a senior gathering place. That little area looks rough, but I tell you what, it could be cleaned up and made very attractive very easily. Thank you.
Thank you.
I didn't talk. I just
want to confirm that. That is correct. The policy is only to have rebuttals if a name was mentioned. We move to question six, and this one, Bill will have the first opportunity to answer. What are your first two steps to address affordable housing in Ward 2? What are your first two steps to address affordable housing in Ward 2?
One, the number one driver of housing costs, particularly for rents, is higher and higher taxes. Unending fees, unending assessments. I've heard that from people countless times. All of you right now have the power to vote on school levy increases. You should be given the right to vote on property tax increases, proposed ones, fees and assessments. And two, there is no magic bullet for creating enough affordable housing for the need out there. There's thousands of units in this city. There's some more being created, enough to fill the need. Probably not. One thing that a number of you are aware of is on Craigslist, in the last 10, 15 years, there's been an explosion of people renting out portions of their homes at a very affordable rate. And it offers really many wonderful, wonderful opportunities for people to cohabitate affordably. Thank you.
Thank you. Next, we have Helen.
Well, as I said, earlier, decent housing is going to remain unaffordable for millions of working people as long as the land is privatized and the market sets the amount of money in which housing will, which people will have to pay for housing. It will take a fight of working people in this country to come to power in order to change how land is distributed in this country and used in the interests of the majority. As I said, I'm for nationalization of the land, and I'm for it going into the hands, in the case of farmers, to till the soil as opposed to the banks and the landlords. And then we'll have the opportunity to develop urban land based on the needs of those who live upon it, not the financial interests of the banks and the big developers. It won't change under as long as the current system stays in place and we don't organize a workers' and farmers' government.
Rebecca?
Thank you. Affordable housing is one of my top priorities in office, and the two things I would do, first, the inclusionary zoning policy that I mentioned earlier, because we simply do not have the funds to continue to subsidize affordable housing. We need to make that be a requirement for every development to take advantage of the market rate growth. But the second thing we need to do, and what I've been doing, is talking to my microphone the right way, is advocate for affordable housing in our ward. I wanted to respond to Bill earlier because the project on Stryker, the Affordable Senior Housing Project, is something I've been championing. And I don't know how people feel about the design of it, but I know a heck of a lot of people I've been talking to want to see more affordable housing for seniors in our neighborhood so they can age in place. So I'm excited about that. Those projects take a lot of work to shepherd them through all of the myriad funding streams and regulations that they need to get through to happen. And so one of the things I'm doing is working really closely with those developers to make sure that they're able to get through those to get the affordable housing up more quickly.
Thank you. Lindsay?
Thank you. I think first and foremost, we need to look at low-key options and low-cost solutions, and we need to add a human scale to our thought process. I also think that we need to change our idea of what affordable housing looks like. It's not just shoving people into apartment buildings or apartments that are 150 square feet. It's leveraging homes that we have here, gems that we have here on the west side and all throughout Ward 2, and bridging the wealth gap through home ownership and empowering, as Bill kind of hit on it, empowering our neighbors to leverage their house as additional forms of revenue and income. And we should be incentivizing our neighbors to look at redevelopment incentives and rehabilitation of home incentives and repair incentives as well.
Thank you. The next question, Helen,
reply to Rebecca.
I'm sorry, you weren't mentioned by name. So
yeah, she was. Yeah, it was.
Did you?
Yes,
I'm sorry. Okay.
Yeah.
That would be correct then. Yes.
Okay. I've let drop the whole ward, and I think 100% of the comments about that senior housing up on Stryker, nobody's against it, or against the fact that it's affordable for seniors. What they're against is the design. They feel it's cheap and it's and very inappropriate for that neighborhood. And I've not seen a design, but frankly, the seniors who will be living there, it sounds like they deserve much better than what they're going to be getting. And if I'm elected, it will be something beautiful and very complimentary to that neighborhood. Thank you.
Thank you. We move to the next question. For this question, Helen Myers will get the first opportunity to respond. What services or other items in St. Paul's budget do you consider unnecessary or would cut in order to fund your priorities? What services or other items in St. Paul's budget do you consider unnecessary or would cut in order to fund your priorities?
I think the entire budget doesn't meet the need of the majority of working people in this city. And without a complete change in the course of the government, change in the way in which priorities are met, not by capitalist class who is interested in profit first, and human needs second. But we need to fight for a different government, for a change in government. That's how the only way we'll change our priorities. And a government, as I've said, of workers and powers. There has to be a struggle in this city and in this country where the outcome is in the interest of the majority, where decisions are made on what affects the majority, not what makes money. And until that is done, and that struggle I believe is possible, and I believe more and more people are open to the idea that the long-term two-party system is gone, that we
Please
will be...
Stop. Thank you. Next, we have Rebecca.
Thank you. This is a really good time of year for that question because we're in the middle of setting our budget for 2020, and every year I look really closely to see where I can find efficiencies in our city budget. One of the areas that I'm interested in this year is in our business assistance funds. We have a number of several hundreds of thousands of dollars worth of funds that we use to attract and to support small businesses. But I'm interested in figuring out if we can leverage private partnerships with the Chamber of Commerce and with the Port Authority and even with private banks to help us leverage the money that we have rather than continuing to put in more public dollars, especially when you look year over year and see that we haven't fully utilized all of those funds. That's a way, to me, a red flag of showing that's something that we might be able to cut back on. I'm also interested in auditing our departments in general and restarting the council's oversight function to make sure that all of our departments are being as efficient as possible with every public dollar. When we come to you for higher taxes, the very least we owe you is to show you that we're being accountable with the money that you're giving.
Thank you. Bill Hosko, please.
Could you repeat the question?
Certainly. What services or other items in St. Paul's budget do you consider unnecessary or you would cut in order to fund your priorities?
I think a lot of us can agree we could start with the mayor's abundant staff. And then if I'm elected, the next budget, nothing I can do about this one, is I want to hear from you. That's my job, is to hear from you what you think is unnecessary. I hear from too many people that basic services are not being taken care of. Thank you.
Thank you. And we have Lindsay.
First and foremost, as I mentioned early on, that I really am looking toward redundancies in our budget, and I've already found a few given the vague information I was given, just like every other member of public was during the 2020 budget discussion that was open to the public. There was something in there that was a business service that was taxed to residents, but also the businesses were also being taxed for the same service. That's a redundancy and something that we don't, as neighbors, need to pay for when our businesses are already being taxed for that service. And if we're looking for transparency and accountability in the budget, again, I have to go back to how much of our public funds are being diverted to a TIF fund. We have no idea of how big that fund is. We just know, for example, that the Ford Development Project is looking for upwards of $200 million in public funds.
Thank you. The next question, we have Bill first. West Siders use Eide Mill Road more than other folks in any other ward. What's your view on the mayor's proposal to restrict car traffic to half the road and use the other half for pedestrians and bikes?
If you go to HoskoForWard2.com, I made a short video on this. You know, I don't own a car. I've been borrowing one during this campaign, and I would have been biking, but somebody stole my bike. Eide Mill Road... Most of you drive. I mean, there's, I think, 12,000 cars a day that use that. You cannot reduce it down to two lanes. You just can't. I mean, they're all going to go over to Lexington, and my crossing Lexington now, you almost feel like you're going to get run over. I think there's enough public land down there to really explore a bike and walking path down there. Not pavement, sod pavement, but maybe crushed rock, something more natural. I don't know if it's possible to get a little bit of the railroad right away down there through a lease, to have both, but the traffic does need to stay. Thank you.
Thank you. Next we have Lindsay.
I like this question for a couple of reasons, is that I really have an affinity for a biking community, and that means our recreational bikers, our athletic bikers, our lifestyle bikers. And I work with some of our biking community and businesses as well. And they have been really torn about Eide Mill Road. We do need a good thoroughfare for our neighbors. Most of us, and on average, according to our stats, own two vehicles. We can ignore that, but that doesn't mean that St. Paul has to take on the brunt of that refinish ourselves. We can be leveraging other counties and other cities and communities to help us as well, and we have to be more thoughtful with our biking strategy and pathways and making sure it's something that everybody can benefit from, most importantly, safely, and maybe even promote retail or commerce in other areas using a strategic biking concept.
Thank you, Rebecca.
I admire the mayor's boldness, and I'm excited about the vision that he's proposing for Ide Mill Road. In general, I'm a huge supporter of expanding bike lanes and making it easier to get around without a car throughout our city. That said, I still have a lot of questions, and I'm missing a lot of information about this proposal, and I am not the kind of person who likes to make decisions ideologically or without having the full information available to me. So, for example, we don't yet know what the fiscal impacts will be, what the traffic impacts will be, or what the opportunity cost for the other pedestrian and bike infrastructure that we're trying to work on will be. For example, I've been pushing so hard to finish our Capital City Bikeway downtown, of which we have one leg of four completed. I want to make sure this doesn't detract from our efforts to finish that up first before we take on new work. So I'm cautiously optimistic, but there's a lot more information we need, and we're going to be asking for a public hearing before we move forward with that plan.
Thank you. Helen?
I'd rather a connector between 94 and 35E, but I'll set that aside. I think that the problem is that we need the roads and the both the maintenance of the roads and the roads themselves in this ward, city, state, country need huge federal funded investment in improvement for safety, for ease of driving, for allowing people to both drive and bike. But I think the real thing is that the budgets have to, that the people who organize and organize the budgets in this city or federal or state level, organize them in what improves their class interests, what's best for them, and not what's best for the majority. And I think we have to change the system so that we determine how the budget is spent, and it can't be done as long as you live in a country, in a system which is puts profit before human needs.
Thank you. The next question Bill will have first. How would you interact with the city's legal department related to the lawsuits that are costing millions of taxpayers' dollars?
I'm going to talk to you about something that I think it's an ongoing, well, two things real quick that are possible liabilities for the city. The Jackson Street bike path downtown. My business is on the corner of 7th and Jackson downtown. I have watched 250 cars go down that bike path because there's not a bollard there. I've written city council offices and the mayor's office a number of times warning them about what's going to happen there. Somebody's going to get hit. It's just a matter of time, and a good attorney's going to recognize what has happened, and the city's going to get sued. The other thing is the scooters. Some of us love them. Some of us hate them. They're a liability for the city. They're being left on the sidewalks randomly. I can't imagine what it's like for a person who has low sight or who is blind, but it's a matter of time before somebody is struck by a scooter while riding on the sidewalk, and again, a good attorney's going to go after the city who has the deepest pockets.
Thank you. Next, we have Helen.
Well, I'm not for interaction with I think there's no solution to interaction with the legal department or with any department in the government as it's now constructed, because the decisions in the courts, in the council, and other regulatory bodies of the city are all made in the interests of the wealthy in this city and not in the interest of meeting the needs of regular working people.
Thank you. Lindsay?
I didn't hear the first part of what you said. I just heard lawsuits.
Certainly. How would you interact with the city's legal department related to the lawsuits that are costing millions of taxpayer dollars?
Interact, that's a key word. with the city's attorney, first and foremost, we have a glaring issue where our city attorneys and our city council attorneys in the last few months have really gone against our city's charter and reworked it
to fit an agenda, and that's a problem. Even though the court has ruled in favor of the city charter over and over again, yet our city council and our leadership is continuing to fight us over and over again regarding this charter issue. So I think that if we stay true to the integrity of our city charter and our state constitution, and we really think out our policies and our ordinances or whatever we want to implement, and do it with research, good research, and with the concept of benefit to all, that we can avoid a lot of lawsuits to begin with. More importantly, we have to uphold the integrity of our city's charter.
Thank you. Rebecca?
First of all, I am as frustrated as anyone when I feel we haven't gotten good legal advice and when our legal bills are run up as a result of it. I do my best in the position that I'm in to ask hard questions to make sure that when we're in our conferences with our lawyers, we are pushing back, we are trying to get to the root of the matter, trying to really understand the reasoning behind the advice that they're giving us, and also to learn from the past and to change our policies accordingly. And one really good example of that is how our police department has completely redone its use of force policies and its canine policies in response to not only the legal issues that we are finding ourselves in, but also in response to what is right. And we have seen, as a result, those lawsuits and those dollars going down dramatically because of the change in policy. So we can learn from the past, we can do better.
Thank you. Lindsay? I'm sorry, we just finished that question. I apologize. I was already thinking about the next one. Okay. Please share your perspective on immigrants, including those without documentation.
Is this me first?
Yes, Lindsay.
I'm just writing so I don't forget. This is a tough question for a lot of us. I am a third generation American. My grandparents were the first ones born in this country. But most importantly, when it came down to it and integrating into this country, we focused on our United States Constitution, the rules and regulations of our state, and our city as well. I think that, again, when we hold true the integrity of our city's constitution, our state's constitution, and our United States Constitution, that we will always win.
Thank you. Rebecca?
I am so proud of St. Paul for being the welcoming community that it is, that was built by immigrants. One of the reasons that my husband and I chose to raise our family on the West Side was because of the proud history and tradition of this neighborhood of welcoming immigrants, much like my own family. I'm descended from Russian Jews, and we are literally sitting almost in the exact spot where so many of my people came over and were welcomed here. Immigrants are some of the hardest working, most courageous, ironically most American of any of us. And I am thrilled that St. Paul has continued to stand up for everyone who is here to stand back and push back against the Trump rhetoric of hate. And while I agree that we need, at a national level, to look at our immigration policies at that level, I am proud that St. Paul is a welcoming place that stands by everyone who's here.
Thank you. Helen?
I stand for amnesty for all undocumented immigrants in this country and in this city, of course, as well. I believe that it's not, I say to U.S.-born workers all the time, it's in all our interests that there be amnesty granted. Because short of that, that's how we're divided. That's how wages go down. If there's full amnesty, the bosses can't divide it. It's a life or death question for unions in this country as well. I stand for driver's licenses for all, and I'm opposed to the deportation raids.
Thank you. Bill?
Ladies and gentlemen, we are a city, a county, a state, and a nation of laws. What do we become when leadership decides which laws we should and shouldn't follow? Not you, but leadership. Some would say maybe a dictatorship. I would like to ask Councilmember Incumbent Neeker, what specifically have you done since taking office to change U.S. immigration law to allow people who are here illegally to be full citizens? I mean, what specifically have you done to change U.S. immigration law in these last 3 years?
Because Rebecca Naker was mentioned by name, she'll have 30 seconds to rebut.
Thank you, Bill. It's difficult at the city level to change federal policy toward immigration, but one of the roles that I think the city council has taken in the last few years has been to use our political positions, our positions of influence, to speak out against the Trump agenda of hate. We have passed numerous resolutions at our council and joined with many other cities across the country in speaking about our values towards immigrants and in pushing the government to follow suit.
Thank you. The next question, this will be the last question prior to closing statements. We'll close with something positive. What is something you love about the city and or a project you are excited about? And this one we'll begin with Helen Myers. So what is something you love about the city and or a project you are excited about?
Well, I like I love St. Paul Vera. I like it very much. But I think the real thing is I look forward to when we'll be able to build a St. Paul, build a Minnesota, build a country in which the economic, social, and moral crises we see and face in our everyday life are obliterated from this earth. And it will only happen when working people join together, use our power, and change this government.
Thank you, Lindsay.
What I love about St. Paul is a lot of the reasons that I'm running for city council this year. And the reason being is my neighbors. I love my neighbors. I love the businesses that I work for. I love the heritage businesses. I love our architectural charm of our different neighborhoods and nooks in Ward 2, as diverse as they are from each part of the ward. And I love the traditions that many of my neighbors have and that I get to learn from because we are so diverse. I have a true affinity for St. Paul, which is interesting because when I first moved to Minnesota, I was a Minneapolis girl. And my husband, an East Sider, pulled me across the river and said, "You're gonna love it here." And I said, "What? Nope." But sure enough, he won me over, and now I can't remember the last time I've been to Minneapolis except to start for the Twin Cities Marathon. And that's about it. So I love my neighbors, and I love what makes St. Paul so unique. And that goes from one section of our ward to another.
Thank you. Bill?
Quickly, most of you don't, well, those of you who do know, I've spent my entire adult life illustrating and painting St. Paul. I don't think there's another artist alive that has a larger body of work than me. One of the things I'd love to see that I'm enjoying seeing right now is all of the residential growth. A number of the buildings could have been better than they were, but that growth is wonderful to see. The proposal on Stryker, it's a wonderful thing that's going to happen. Again, the design needs to be improved. The rehabbing of vacant buildings, particularly downtown. The old exchange building has just been turned into a boutique hotel. Lovely job. There's probably a number of other things that I can talk about, but I'm about to renew my lease downtown for 5 years with a 5-year option, so I plan on sticking around. Thank you.
Thank you. Rebecca?
This is such a hard question because there's so much to love about Ward 2 and about St. Paul, but I guess I would just limit it to one thing and say that I love the fact that St. Paul is the kind of place where this room is packed to the gills on a Tuesday night, on a cold Tuesday night, to hear about local politics. We are the kind of people who care, who show up, and who get things done, and that's one of the reasons why I've been so honored to be on the City Council representing you for the last 4 years. One of the projects I'm really excited about for the future is the continuation of the St. Paul Business Awards. This is a program I started with my colleagues when I took office, and it's an opportunity to recognize the small business owners doing amazing things in our neighborhoods. We bring them to the City Council every year to honor them, and there are literally tears in their eyes and in everyone's eyes in the room when they talk about how much they pour into their small businesses, making our neighborhoods great. It's one of my favorite days of the year, and I can't wait to honor our next class of them in the spring.
Thank you. In closing, we apologize if your question was not asked. We can never get to all the issues in a limited format such as this, and there were many excellent questions we couldn't use this evening. We encourage you to speak to the candidates at the close of the forum. The closing statements will be given in reverse order from the opening statements. Please remember, candidates, you have 2 minutes to conclude your remarks. So first, we have Bill Hosko.
Thank you. First, I'd like to thank the League of Women Voters and this Villa del Sol Community Center. It's very nice for making tonight's event possible. Secondly, and most importantly of all, I would like to thank all of those in attendance here tonight and those at home as well who will be viewing tonight at a later date. It's nice that you're taking an interest in this race and these important topics. As I've said many times now, I'm applying for a job, ladies and gentlemen. I've said it to many people as I've been out lit dropping. It's a job to work for and represent you at City Hall, and I will do so to the very best of my abilities if I'm elected. If you hire me, I promise that things will change for the better, much, much better, on the west side and throughout this ward. And hopefully on our journey, there will be more new faces representing other wards as well. So Patty Hartman on Ward 3 and Jamie Hendrickson in Ward 5, give them a look. Together, we can restore St. Paul's luster and improve your life here. We can. And I sincerely say that I do hope to be working for you come this January 2020. And I do mean that. Thank you.
Thank you. Next, we have Helen Myers.
Well, as I began, and I'll end with, the biggest task facing working people is to organize and act independently of the two political parties that exist and the ruling capitalist parties. I'm for whatever renews class solidarity and self-confidence, advancing working people to a course towards a united workers' power in this country. I've said in the course of discussing here, but briefly again, I do support amnesty for undocumented workers and a federally financed government jobs program at union wages to build and fix the roads, to build quality affordable housing, health care for all. And I oppose the wars that Washington is, and I call for the United States troops to come back. And I think it's city responsibility to also, those of us in the city, to also have be concerned and have concern of federal responsibility as well. But as I began, only through struggle can the working class discover our fighting capacities and our worth. We can and we must put an end to the exploitation, the violence, the racial discrimination, the class-based pecking orders, and the dog-eat-dog values of capitalism. And I invite you to join my party and join us in campaigning. We've been going door to door. We raise these issues with people. We get a hearing, and we're very confident about the future.
Thank you. Rebecca Naker.
I really appreciate the conversation we've had tonight. I want to thank my fellow candidates and all of you for being here, for your engagement in these really critical issues. As I said at the beginning, I have so much hope for St. Paul and for everything that we can do together. And my goal for the next 4 years is really just to keep doing what we've been doing tonight, to continue this conversation, to listen first, to work really, really hard, and to get things done for our ward. And I want to focus on that getting things done, because I think it is really important who we elect to this seat. We only get one representative for our ward on the city council, and it's important that we get the absolute most out of that seat. When I was elected 4 years ago, I quit my full-time job because I knew I wanted to dedicate myself full-time and beyond full-time to being your council member. And I have shown in the last 4 years that I have the ability to get things done for our ward. I have the relationships, the experience, the knowledge of City Hall to continue getting results and making our community better. So I really appreciate your being here tonight. I hope I can count on your support on November 5th.
Thank you. Lindsay Ferris Martin.
So some of you may not know why I'm running. In the middle of June this year, my husband and I actually interviewed our third realtor, and we're planning on putting our house on the market. We had to interview several realtors because we had a huge hurdle to overcome, and that was a problem property and the amount of crime in our neighborhood. And if anybody were to do some research, they might look the other way and run. We needed a realtor who could overcome this objection and sell our house skillfully. We wanted to move so that my 7-year-old would have at least one opportunity to ride her bike carefree around the block so that she could play in her front yard without dodging bullets or encountering one of the many people who walked around high or stoned in our neighborhood. After all, children only get 18 summers to be carefree, and this year, we wanted that year to be hers. My neighbors and I were victimized by a problem property. St. Paul Police Department actually deemed them one of the top 20 problem properties in all of the city. Our neighbors were subjected to drive-by shooting, stabbing, and open-air drug uses all within feet of a school and playground. We fought tirelessly for 24/7, 10 months straight to get rid of this problem property. We asked our current leadership for help to enforce any one of the city ordinances for problem properties. Not one was leveraged. 10 of my neighbors moved this year. I would have been the 11th. They moved between April and June of this year. Instead of moving, I decided to fight for my neighbors that I was losing, because to lose them was a huge loss to our community. I'm fighting to keep our neighbors here and to fix our basic needs for a decent quality of life, to protect the rights given to us under our city charter, to protect the income of my neighbors who work so hard for their money and for their retirement and for their savings. I want to make sure that we stop abusing our residents with outrageous tax increases that don't produce beneficial services for all.
Thank you. I would like to remind the audience that the views expressed in this forum are those of the candidates, not those of the sponsoring organizations, the League of Women Voters, and the Cherokee Park United Church. On behalf of the sponsoring organizations, I would like to thank the candidates for being part of this forum and recognize them for serving their community through participating in the democratic process and running for public office. I would also like to thank the audience here at Villa del Sol Community Room and at home for watching your candidates discuss issues that are important to your community. This forum will be aired in its entirety on your local public cable channel. Please check the channel directly for air times. The forum will also be available for viewing on demand at the St. Paul Neighborhood Network website, spnn.org. Every vote count. This year's election day is Tuesday, November 5th. The polls are open from 7 a.m. until 8 p.m. Early voting is also an option. Please remember to take a friend and a neighbor and vote on Tuesday, November 5th. Thank you and good night.